गुड मॉर्निंग सर.
गुड मॉर्निंग.
सर, यू हैव बीन वर्किंग एज अ सीनियर मैनेजर फॉर द एक्सटर्नल रिलेशंस एंड मीडिया डिपार्टमेंट एट द वर्ल्ड ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस ऑफ द स्काउट मूवमेंट. सो कैन यू टेल अस ब्रीफली एज टू व्हाट योर वर्क पोर्टफोलियो इंटेल्स यू टू डू?
आई एम रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर स्काउटिंग्स रिलेशनशिप विद ऑल द पार्टनर ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस, पर्टिकुलरली द UN एजेंसीज, द अदर यूथ ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस, द कॉर्पोरेट सेक्टर, the civil society networks. So my area is to represent our scout movement with those entities and also represent those entities within the scout movement to bring their interests, their needs, and to see how we can fulfill or play a role in a constructive way as part of the society. And I'm also responsible for the media globally. So I take care of our web and all the social media outlets. And I try to help the communications department with a lot of our editorial work is done by me. We have a big team of volunteers and professionals who work on these things. So I sit and coordinate these things in Geneva for the global headquarters of the Scout Movement.
Of the Scout Movement.
Yeah.
Sir. And sir, you have made immense progress in developing the policies which eccentrically focus on child and youth development.
Yeah.
So how does working with an NGO help you in the same, or will a government organization be more efficient because even they can enforce these policies more effectively, right?
Definitely. I think this question is a good one because it helps us understand the complementary nature or to question what is the role of both the entities. The very positioning of non-government organization, as it is called, non-government, puts us through a very easy positioning of understanding that they are not what government is. So that itself questions the legitimacy of the outreach of government or puts a clear mandate for the non-government organizations to reach those that the government doesn't reach. So is that a judgment on the government processes? Possibly yes, possibly no. But maybe it is also a support to understand how far and how difficult the government's work is to reach out to everybody, and particularly to marginalized communities and interest groups. Because when you put a formula which is one size fits all, it is very difficult for you to reach out, particularly those who get marginalized, because the system's dynamics become such that the people who rise to the top make use of the opportunities and the others at the bottom of the pyramid get left out. Now, the NGOs come and represent those interests. So when you talk about child and youth programs, when you talk about working with marginalized communities, disabled people, women who have been left out in societies where we are still very male dominated, and talking about all of those groups that are marginalized, to bring their voices out, to end their suffering, NGOs form a good way of uniting those voices and forces, and to help the government also, to show them that these are things that you need to do to take care of these interests. Otherwise, you are basically failing in fulfilling the needs that you have claimed that you will fulfill. So the NGOs play that role. Whereas when it comes to developing expertise in areas, I think it is very important for the non-government organizations also to understand that there are other people who are having expertise in this. Mm. We can't assume because we are bringing the voices of the poor that we know everything. Mm. We need to understand that there are knowledge institutions like that of your own universities, there are corporate sectors who can bring resources. We need to understand the strength of the government, because the government is a huge operation. There is a lot of funding there. There are institutions set up and structure, like, you know, funding mechanisms, and all of these need to come together to help the causes for which the non-government organizations are fighting for.
Okay. And now coming to the course you took here in GNLU, can you give us a brief summary about the merits of understanding the workings of an NGO for a law student?
I mean, when I started the course here, I put a perspective that this could help the students in three different ways. One of it is to think in terms of themselves being future entrepreneurs, opening social entrepreneurship ventures, or becoming managers in non-profit organizations, non-government organizations, or opening their own NGOs. I mean, this is one way of using this experience. Another experience, and a more important and probably a subtle thing that I wish will be the case for most of the students, will be when they pursue their future lives in law or whatever chosen field as they go into master's and specialization, that they will remember the learning from this experience. that they will be able to use it when they deal with non-profit organizations. When they will work with either governments or corporates, that they understand that this entity exists out there and they can be harnessed, or they need to be supported or nurtured or cultured to bring this benefit that they can bring in raising the people's voices. So that was a second way that I wanted the students to benefit. A third way is to look at the small group of people who work for legal aspects of non-profit organizations. So like my own organization, we have our own lawyer. We have a treasurer who's also a lawyer. It's useful. I mean, so these people are coming with very strong understanding of the Swiss law framework, but largely giving us also an international legal understanding. What is the overall flow of legal frameworks in the world over? Because our presence is in 200 countries. We can't just understand the Swiss law and say we'll apply it to everywhere. I mean, another country based on Sharia law, what will you do with your Swiss law understanding there? So you have to really understand the broader frameworks. But these students who have been here and who will get to work on legal aspects for non-profit organizations, they will be able to develop it further.